The hand of God was manifest when the United States of America came into being. It was evident even before then. Before disembarking from the Mayflower, our Pilgrim Fathers drafted and signed the compact, which was to become the instrument of their governance, the first such document drafted on this continent. It began with these words, "In the name of God, amen." It went on to say that the signers, quote, "By these presents solemnly and mutually in the presence of God and one another, covenant and combine ourselves together into a civil body politic." When George Washington resigned his commission of General of the Army, he wrote, "I consider it an indispensable duty to close this last act of my official life, but commending the interests of our dearest country to the protection of Almighty God and those who have the superintendence of them to His holy keeping." As Crystal has reminded us tonight, in his first inaugural address in 1789, he stated, "No people can be bound to acknowledge and endure the invisible hand which conducts the affairs of men more than the people of the United States. Every step by which they have advanced to the character of an independent nation seems to have been distinguished by some token of providential agency." We posted the colors tonight and stood and gave a pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands. We said, "One nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all." That phrase, "one nation under God," essentially comes from Abraham Lincoln. In the great Gettysburg Address, he stated, quote, "that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom," close quote. That phrase was not in the Pledge of Allegiance that was spoken when I was a boy. Back in those days, all of us in grade school, when the weather permitted, would form at the front steps of the school. The flag would be posted, and we would recite together the Pledge of Allegiance before going into the building for our daily schoolwork. I am grateful for the addition of the words, "one nation under God," to me. It is tremendously meaningful. There are those in this nation today who would delete all of this reference to deity. They would take it out of the Pledge of Allegiance. They would take it from our coinage. They would remove it from any mention in our national life. John Wesley Hill has written, "Gettysburg was the high water mark of the rebellion. It involved the destiny of the Union." Realizing this, it was Lincoln who, while that battle was being fought, was driven to his knees to struggle like Jacob of old, alone with God, until, in Lincoln's own words, "God told me he would give me Gettysburg, and I believed him." When the news of the victory reached him, he gave to God the glory and set aside a day of national thanksgiving. When Mrs. Margaret Thatcher was on this campus and I was talking with her, she said, "I cannot understand it. You have the motto, 'In God we trust,' on your coinage, and yet you cannot mention the name of deity in the classrooms of your schools." She wondered, and I wonder about our consistency. At this meeting tonight, the first verse of our national anthem was sung. We seldom hear the third verse, which includes these words, "Oh, thus be it ever when free men shall stand between their loved homes and the war's desolation. Blessed with victory and peace, may the heaven-rescued land praise the power that hath made and preserved us a nation. Then conquer we must when our cause it is just, and this be our motto, 'In God is our trust.'" As boys who would grow to become citizens of this nation, we repeated the Scout Oath, including these words, On my honor, I will do my best to do my duty to God and my country. Now even that is being challenged in the courts of the land. According to the Wall Street Journal, the state of New Jersey last year passed a law banishing the mention of God from state courtroom oaths. Following this action by the legislature, a county judge decided to ban Bibles for such oaths because, quote, "you know who is mentioned inside," close quote. Without acknowledgement of deity, without recognition of the Almighty as the ruling power of the universe, the all-important element of personal and national accountability shrinks and dies. Are we so arrogant as to believe that we can get along without him? We see the manifestation of that arrogance in the great host of social problems with which we deal these days. Teen pregnancy, abandoned families and broken homes, failure to recognize the property and rights of others, gangs of young people aimlessly cruising the streets of our cities, and many other problems like these have resulted in substantial part, at least, from failure to recognize that there is a God to whom someday each of us must give an accounting. The wars in which this nation has been involved during this, the most bloody century of all time, have resulted from the greed, the avarice, the arrogance, the conceit and egotism of men in power who sought to enslave and exercise dominion over others. Their very attitude has been totally incompatible with recognition of the Almighty to whom each of us is accountable. There can be no doubt of the sickness in our society today. We cannot build prisons fast enough to accommodate the need. Humanism has replaced worship in the lives of so very many. We are forsaking the Almighty, and I fear he is forsaking us. We are closing the door against the God whose sons and daughters we are. We sing, "My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty." We need to sing again and again the fourth verse of that hymn. Our fathers, God to thee, author of liberty, to thee we sing. Long may our land be bright with freedom's holy light. Protect us by thy might, great God our King. Going back to George Washington's first inaugural speech, he voiced the hope that the foundations of our national policy will be laid in the pure and immutable principles of private morality. He went on to say, "There is no truth more thoroughly established than that there exists an indissoluble union between virtue and happiness, between duty and advantage, between genuine maxims of an honest and magnanimous policy and the solid rewards of public prosperity and felicity, since we ought to be no less persuaded that the propitious smiles of heaven can never be expected on a nation that disregards the eternal rules of order and right which heaven itself has ordained."